Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back. Thank you for staying back for this particular session. I'm so sure that this is an interesting session because this is a unique session, actually. We are going to talk here about the informal segment of the Indian economy, which is actually tapped by the BFSI companies, which is actually, you know, showing a lot of interest to BFSI companies. But still, there are a lot of obstacles, a lot of issues, and somewhere the challenges are how to deal with it. You know, there is no clear answer to it. So let me try to put some focus here in terms of how BFSI companies should actually offer credit, or specifically lenders should offer credit to the, you know, informal sector such as SMEs and, you know, the small entrepreneurs. And I have two gentlemen here with me who will give a better perspective because they are representing this sector. So let me tell you, dear participant in the session, the topic of this particular session on the third day of ETBFSI Converge is formalizing credit for informal sector. And the two speakers that I have with me are Raman Agrawal, the director FIDC. Mr. Agrawal, glad to have you.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure.
And my next speaker is Alok Mishra, CEO, director MFIN. Mr. Mishra, glad to have you.
Thanks, Samul. Good to be here.
Great. So, gentlemen, to begin with, let me ask one basic question to both of you. And Ramanji, I will start with you. My question to you is, what is the major challenge for the lenders in offering credit to SMEs, MSMEs? Because at one side, I see a rally from the BFSI segment, whole BFSI segment, that we should look at SMEs and MSMEs far more aggressively. The Prime Minister, Finance Minister also talk that we should empower the SMEs and MSMEs and the small businessmen. But on the ground, you know, there is not much is happening. There is a rally, you know, in a very stipulated manner. So, Ramanji, please tell us, you know, what are the challenges there?
I think that's a very, very important question, Amol, you've raised, especially in the current context now that we've just hopefully on the cusp of ending that pandemic era. And we've had a lot of challenges for this informal sector. See, for if I speak for the NBFCs, you're absolutely right that MSME lending is the flavor of the day as the focus, right? Because there we see a huge untapped market for us, yeah? While the potential is massive. If you ask me challenges, I would straight away say sourcing business for NBFCs, I don't think has never been a challenge or a big issue. It's more been on the commensurate policy and regulations. I think that has been the key challenge. Sometimes we feel that, you know, while government has been, and rightly so, focusing heavily on this segment, some of the policies, the regulations tend to play a counter role sometimes, you know, and maybe they are not keeping pace with the kind of the requirements of this sector. Because one very key element for lending to this segment is quote unquote flexibility. You know, you cannot be rigid. You just cannot be rigid with this, because obviously the poor man, you know, the uncertainties in his cash flows is the key word. I'll tell you, a poor man hardly defaults by intent. It's always a circumstantial default which happens purely because of his own cash flows. Kahin par kuch natural calamity ho gaya, somewhere you have some issue localized, or you have global issues like pandemic what we faced. So anything, the first impact will come on that informal borrower. So I think I see the biggest challenge coming from that aspect. Second, of course, is also been the, you know, for NBFCs, the challenge for liquidity. This has been something which has been going on for some time now. While I would appreciate and take this opportunity to put on record our deep appreciation of the concern which both RBI and the government have shown. But unfortunately, the real effect of that liquidity has not percolated down to a large number of small NBFCs. Because if you look at NBFCs itself as a sector, more than 90% of the companies themselves are very small. I mean, you can, pardon me saying it, we can call them the MSMEs of the lending community. You know, so they are themselves MSMEs of the lending community, and small lending to small works out a very brilliant kind of a combination. So the challenges, if you ask me outright, are two. One is the regulatory or the policy level challenges. And second, of course, has been the liability side, that is the fundraising side, liquidity.
And both the points are very valid, Ramanji, regulatory as well as the fundraising. In fact, we had seen a major challenge with the NBFCs facing liquidity. In fact, there was a dried up, you know, complete for at least 2 quarters. There was no liquidity at all available for NBFCs. Alokji, I will come to you and I would like to take your perspective. What kind of challenges do you see when it comes to lending to the smaller sectors from the banking and finance companies?
Thanks, Amol. Pretty much, first of all, I will build only on what Ramanji has said, because he has captured the basic points of liquidity and regulatory issues. But let me also say the sector which I represent, the microfinance sector, whether it is from NBFC side or bank side or SFBs, we incorporate all those entities in our ambit. Within the MSMEs also, we are at the M part, the beginning M part, the micro part. It's because when you talk about MSME, it's a big conglomerate. You can have an industry with 5,000 crore turnover and you can have one with 20 lakh turnover, micro enterprises. And as you know, in India, currently there are around 65 million MSMEs as per Government of India's record. And out of that, around, I think if I'm not wrong, 62 or 63 million belong to the micro segment. And most of them are proprietorship companies and we take care of their needs. So there the challenges, not only to what Ramanji has said, there are other challenges also. The foremost of the challenge is that sourcing business, it cannot be, what should I say, what is the current flavor of the season, the cloud-based retailing of credit, the digital lending and all that, that doesn't work. You have to be flexible. You have to be on the ground. You have to deploy manpower to it. You have to understand the life cycle needs of the, because the, it is not a clear segregation at that level between the livelihood activity or the enterprise activity and the life of the client. It is not an incorporated entity where you deal with concepts of limited liability and all those things. And these are integral to somebody running a flour mill, somebody running a trade shop. So you have to understand the client. You have to invest in it. And the sourcing part of it has a challenge. Challenge not in terms of demand. There is enough demand. But you have to deploy and the policy has to be flexible to accept that when you do that type of sourcing, there are costs associated with it.
Right.
You cannot simply raise the boogie of cost and get away with it. So understanding client, trying to be combining elements of both physical and digital, what we call phygital approach in our business, you have to source it. Though front-end services like disbursing the loan, collection, that can be digital, but you have to go there. There has to be boot on the ground, what we call it. And the demand side of it, I told you about the numbers of the micro enterprises. Currently, the microfinance sector reaches 6 crore or 60 million low-income women borrowers across India. So that is 6 crores. And what we see and what we have through various studies, whether it is NSSO data or it is the NCR survey, we have found the target market is somewhere between 30 to 40 crores. So still a lot of demand is there. So as Ramanji was telling, not much of constraints on the demand side. There is enough demand and its importance is also there because if you want, you can have a GDP growth of 8%. But if these persons are left behind, you will never be able to bridge the gap between Bharat and India, what we call it. And you will never do an inclusive growth. People sitting in NCR and Bombay can have crores of income, but these fellows will be left behind. And that will not be good for society. The other challenges on the policy side, I always feel that because I have had a career in banking at the Central Banking and Apex Banking, I feel that somehow or the other, the policy perception, despite Nachiket Moore committee report in 2014, which called for channel neutrality, that you should not be favorable to bank or to NBFC, I still see traces of it in policy bias, that NBFC is thoda dhyan se dekho, sort of a thing. While many things of banks go unnoticed, I think that should not happen. Both have their own strengths and weaknesses. Like Ramanji was telling, the flexibility, the key, and NBFCs come with it. So give them the fair level playing field. Because I don't want to take much of the time here. But later on, if you want me to elaborate on what is the level playing field,
right,
I will talk about it. And finally, on the liquidity part, correct. That again, all these schemes were done by Government of India and Reserve Bank of India, TLTRO, Credit Guarantee Scheme, ECLGS. All this benefited the sector a lot. But again, in my constituency also, the benefit mainly went to the large size and medium size. When you go to the tail end of it, they are starved for credit because it all works in a spiral. Moment there is a crisis, the credit rating agencies will go on a downgrade business, and the smaller you are, the severe the downgrade it is, and then banks will go away. So that has an effect. And if you get a rating of B minus or a little below, it is difficult to raise bank fund despite government guarantee. So this end of the tail has been suffering. That these are the major policy challenges which we have to take care of.
I think a number of issues that you highlighted, Aloksha, and they are very, very relevant. On the digital part and, you know, the demand part, I will come back to you a little later. But let me shift my gears and, you know, build something on the demand part, you know, with Ramanji. So Ramanji, the good part of all these sectors, which we are calling is informal sectors, whether it's SME, MSME, micro segments and everything. Fortunately, there is still a demand, and that is, you know, very lucrative part for the businesses, which can be a very, which actually the lender should leverage more. But somehow that is not happening, which we discussed. So my question to you, Ramanji, is how can we overcome such obstacles? What is that you think, you know, the lender should do, and what kind of policies should be there so that, you know, this, the demand of the small segment will get justice?
See, I think, Amol, this actually is an extension to what I said earlier. Because as I said, I'm pretty much sure with my 30 years experience in the NBFC sector, that as far as NBFCs go, right from the smallest NBFCs to the large ones, I think, as you rightly said, because, you know, a poor man will always be in need of money. Whether it could be for businesses, it could be for personal needs, or somewhere, because obviously in the vagaries and the uncertainties that we live in, demand for money will always be there. And that ultimately, you know, boils down to demand for credit, which is there in the market. And I think from the lender's perspective, NBFC perspective, they have never been, you know, kind of found lacking in terms of not able to reach on their own, given a conducive policy and regulatory environment. So I think I put against, you know, this the same thing here. I'll just cite one classic example of how, you know, regulatory sometimes overreach. We've had a recent RBI circular on the prudential norms. Right, which first of all, you know, the whole idea, I think, which Alokji mentioned very rightly. See, personally speaking, I don't buy the idea that NBFCs should be regulated at par with banks. See, if you are to do that, then, you know, what is the difference between then bank and NBFC? That typicality of the NBFC model gets lost. As I said, what is the core strength of NBFCs? That flexibility. You know, which matches the borrower's needs. It's not that we want to be flexible. It's the borrower who wants to be flexible. You know, so a recent RBI circular, the change in prudential norms. Now they say while for banks, it was there that, you know, once an asset goes into an NPA to upgrade it, you know, the poor guy has to pay the entire quantum of money, the arrears, only then you can upgrade it. Now, while at a regulatory perspective, it may look that way, why there is a disparity when, you know, both are lending to the small borrowers also. But the point is that, you know, from the borrower's perspective, I correlate to what you asked for the first question. Is it justified? I think no. See, because, you know, in this environment, what you are doing, you are on one hand ensuring that NBFCs don't upgrade it, but more importantly, you are also ensuring that the poor borrower's tag of being an NPA gets prolonged, right? And we know as a system that to carry an NPA tag on your head is a black mark. Yes. No lender will touch you. So you are in a way affecting or directly impacting the credit worthiness of that borrower. Go forget about track record. So that's one example. Second, RBI says now that NBFCs henceforth will have to do day-end accounting into SMA reporting or stressed asset reporting. Mm-hmm. That again, you know, look at, say for example, a owner-driven small truck driver or a tempo driver who drives his own tempo from, you know, various parts of the country. Mm-hmm. How can you expect him to pay it on a daily basis? Mm-hmm. I mean, at that daily meaning at the end of the due date, it is and it is natural. Generally, the collections come in at the month end. Because now, take this argument to a small businessman or any entrepreneur. The small time businessman will always receive his dues and payments from government agencies, from large corporates, or from any other. Generally, they tend to be delayed, you know, and receive on a month end basis. So he would collect that everything, and obviously taking care of his daily or of his family needs would put aside the repayment. So to have a system that you say do a day end kind of a classification does not feel, you know, is not justified. So I think that is where this mismatch has to be corrected. We have to keep in mind, and the idea of bank NBFCs being regulated at par, I think needs a serious rethinking. That cannot be done, because then you are, I would say, severely impacting the typicality of NBFCs of having been able to lend to the unbanked sector. That needs a serious rethinking.
No, noted your points. I think that mismatch point is very valid. And Alokji, I want you to, you know, explain here, you know, why the regulators, the policymakers also, you know, or the large financial institutions give a very different treatment to the micro segment. At one side, they speak really good things about it, and they also speak that how they should empower this. But we have a great example of moratorium. The banks, the large banks actually offered the moratorium to all their, you know, borrowers. But MSMEs kept struggling. I understand even MFIN kept struggling then for a, you know, clarification on the RBI, whether they should offer moratorium to their borrowers or not. And it took really long time for them. So what kind of mismatch is this? How do you actually react to this particular solution? And what kind of clarity do you think you should have, you know, for to scale up the MSMEs?
Thanks, Amol, because this question is basically related to the broader point of the regulatory difference between NBFC and banks. And as Ravaji rightly said, that if both have to be same, then there is no need to have two categories of financial institutions. Right. But at the same time, I would also like to say that it is not only same, but you are now regulating NBFCs even on a higher scale. Let me give you two specific examples. One, before I will come to your point also, what you have raised.
Sure.
First is, Ramanji talked about the recent RBI circular of NPA and prudential norms. There, in case of banks, yes, the logic is there, but banks are under Ind GAAP system of accounting. NBFC, MFI is the major players, or all the other NBFCs are on Ind AS, Indian Accounting Standard, where the provisioning is much accelerated. It is based on expected credit loss methodology. And banks provide start providing only after 90 plus, that is when it becomes NPA, 25%. In our case, by 90 time, when you reach 90, it is almost reaching 100% in microfinance. So you're doing, it's not same, but it's you're going much farther. So I would say that, okay, you don't give us flexibility, but apply Ind GAAP on Ind AS on banks also. Then we'll see the results. So it has to be fair comparison. And we deal with small segment, with microfinance borrowers. You are saying till she clears her four installments, she cannot be upgraded. And Ramanji was telling that once the credit bureau tag of NPA comes, now all lending even in microfinance happens on credit bureau report. And it's once somebody sees NPA, gone. So whatever the little source of sustenance of 30, 40,000 of credit line was available, that is also taken away. So hopefully, we are making representation, so collecting data on it, and we'll get back to it. Maybe there will be some flexibility. But coming back to the question which you asked, like on moratorium. Well, on moratorium, partly your question is not truly correct, because MFIN was very clear that we have to extend moratorium to our borrowers, means NBFC borrowers, that is the end clients. But what we wanted is, because in our case, we are not a deposit-based institution.
Right.
So when we offer moratorium to the clients, the entire solvency issue comes to the fore, because repayments are your main source of managing ALM, because you have to make payments on your debt funding while your funding at the ground level stops under moratorium. So we said, let us be given back-to-back moratorium by our lenders, that is by banks and whatever players they are. But that did not come. So the sector faced a serious double whammy. So we did not get moratorium on our, some people gave on bilateral negotiation. There was no policy clarity, while some did not give. So on an average, 50% lenders to the MFI sector, to the institutions, did not give moratorium, while we gave 100% moratorium at ground level. So that led to severe liquidity issues and prolonging of the crisis. because the liquidity pattern got affected. And again here, the large ones in NBFCs, those who have cash buffers, those who have equity buffers, they are able to absorb the shock better, no? Because they have some cash surplus, they can manage this. But the smaller ones get squeezed, and there was almost near situation of default in some cases or postponement. They will pay only the interest, not the principal. So that was the main issue. But by the time we could make several representations, but nothing came out of it. By the time it was November and the economy already started picking up, opening started, luckily. If it would have prolonged for a long time, you would have seen some smaller institutions rolling up.
Okay, okay.
If you can permit me, I'll add something.
Sure.
A very small point, and directly relating to what you asked about, where is the gap?
Yes.
You know, why this gap comes in. Now, I know howsoever small this issue may sound, but I think this has significance. Let's look at one thing. You know, I have always been voicing this point that why can't we have a platform for a regular periodic dialogue. You know, I'll tell you what, not that RBI does not meet us, not that Ministry of Finance does not meet us. Whenever we have approached them, they've been very open and welcoming. But my point is that we should have a platform created, a kind of a official platform, where both the regulator, the policymakers, and even I would include the chartered accountant community, the auditors, I would say, should be together. And I say this out of experience. I don't know how many people know that prior to 2006 and since 1998, that 7-8 years of era was a time when there was a kind of an informal advisory group constituted by RBI on NBFC. Where they used to invite leading players and some of the leading associations, right? It was informal. They called it informal because there is no statutory provision of creating a formal advisory.
Right.
So there was an informal. And every quarter, it was fixed. Every quarter, there was a meeting chaired by the ED, Executive Director, or Chief General Manager at RBI Central Office. They used to meet, threadbare discuss both ways, you know, the issues from the regulatory perspective, and if the regulator found some of the companies not responding or not doing it, and similarly, the companies giving a feedback. And every policy change was discussed prior to being implemented. The draft was discussed, feedback was sought, and then the issues were put in place. So I think that is something which got stopped in 2006. So I, out of that experience, since I was part of that group, I would say something like this needs to be done. And today, if you look at it, today also, both RBI and Ministry of Finance, the regularity of dialogue they have with banks, and if you compare it to NBFCs or MFIs, there is a wide gap. And that is where I think that needs to also be corrected. My feeling is, my sense is that it will be a win-win for both okay. for the policymakers and the lenders.
Okay. Very valid point, Ramanjan. Thank you so much for adding that. Since we discussed gaps now, since we discussed the obstacles, and we discussed the current situation, now my basic question, which is our theme of the session, obviously we partly discussed that, but let's be very specific to it. And Alokja, I will start with you. My question to you is, you know, to both of you, how to formalize the credit for an informal sector? Because the number of informal, the borrowers in the informal sector are huge, and they are looking for a credit to reach to a next level. And we have to empower them at some level. Otherwise, you know, either they will vanish or they will not stay back in the same business. So how to formalize that sector?
So Amal, I would say that when you talk about formalization, I'm not clear, because when even at a microfinance sector, when we lend, say, 20,000 or 25,000 also to a client, the entire thing is formalized. The money is disbursed into the bank account. Before that, when the sourcing of the client happens, the credit bureau record is checked, the KYC is done, all the records are uploaded in the credit bureau. Everything is a digital process. Only the Aadhaar, it was earlier being deduped with Aadhaar also, but after the Puttuswamy judgment, the Aadhaar thing stopped. Recently, RBI has again come up with a circular that we can use the services of KUA and AUA. So that happens. And the repayment also, we are trying to move disbursements are 100% now into the bank account. While the repayments are still a puzzle to be solved, only 25% repayments, even as small as 300 rupees repayment in microfinance are coming through digital means. We are working on it. So formalization is already there. But if you are talking about formalization in terms of they becoming an incorporated entities, that's a different area at all. Because it often depends on the choice of the enterprise also. And at some level, when you try to make them incorporated, the cost of doing that, or knowledge of doing that, or the training which is required, especially in the microfinance segment, far outweighs the utility of it. So while the government has recently started, as you know, that unless you are registered on the Udyami Mitra portal, you cannot be classified as an MSME. Now, again, that's a very, I have no issues with the point which you raised and the government's policy intent. Yes, formalization is necessary. That gives a control to the policymakers on data that brings the informal sector into the formal sector. That's all very laudable means. Only thing is, you have to think about the enormity of the problem. For example, you cannot vaccinate all the India with double doses and booster doses in 3 months. Similarly, you cannot cover 10 million clients, those who do not have a smartphone, those who have a basic digital phone, to ask them to register on Udyami Mitra portfolio portal by 31st December, or risk being not classified as under MSME and thereby being denied credit by banks or NBFC, because then we will not be able to classify under them MSME and avail the PSL benefit. So that formalization will also happen, but it will happen gradually. You cannot overnight register 10 crore clients. Similarly, things happened with PM Swanidhi. We keep giving feedback. Like we told ministry, in PM Swanidhi scheme also, the urban street vendors were 10,000 rupees you have to give. Those vendors also needed to be registered with the town, local township registration and all that. And many did not have that. So then the message which came to us was that you should help them. Now, it is very difficult for an NBFC staff, which is already overworked, to help the client, train them and make all the clients register on the portal and all do that and do the follow-ups, answer that queries. It will happen. That formalization you are talking about, where the government has a know-how, exact data on how many entities are there, that will also happen. We are all for it, but it will take some time. But on the other aspects, operational aspects, they are already formalized. It all happens through banking channels. The repayment happens through that. So that's my take. I think formalization, from whatever we could do, we have done. And even the recent move of government to bring them all on one portal, that will also be done. But it will take time.
Okay. Ramanshu, do you want to add here on the formalization part?
Yes. I think much Alokji has covered, but just a couple of things. While, on the formalization part, this is correct that, a lot of times, this specially cited Udyami portal, that's also true. But, generally what happens is that we find that when we talk of formalization, there is also sometimes an issue of the financial literacy on the part of these people, right? And I think Alokji's point was absolutely valid. The moment you channelize these people and bring them into the formal credit system, automatically you are formalizing them, because then they will have a track record. They will have a record with the bureaus. And the moment they interact with NBFCs and or banks, whatever, somewhere down the line, if they don't have bank accounts also get opened. So they are very much becoming part of the system. And as he rightly said, let that process be gradual. Let's not jump ki aaj hi system mein bhi aa jaye, aaj hi they become, take PAN, aaj hi they register on Udyam portal, everything happens together. No, it will take time. So I think first, the fact that MFIs or NBFCs are bringing these people into the formal credit system to have a proper tap and a record itself is a first job done. So to move ahead, yes, then we also need to focus on the financial literacy of these people. Because many a times we find, and especially this in the small businesses, they are not able to present their credentials rightly. They may be doing everything right in terms of their business, obviously, because they know the nitty-gritties. They are the best people. They are the absolute grounded people who know how to do business at that level. But they are sometimes not able to present it in the right way, which often becomes a bottleneck when it comes to lending them from the formal sector.
Right.
I think that also is a very important, and we've seen stuff, measures being taken by RBI. A lot of laudable efforts have been done. And you know, I'm just taking a quick point here. We at FIDC have a separate professional development committee. Now we are taking this a step ahead. Not only the formalizing these people, we are also looking at creating a specialized workforce for this kind of lending. And that is where we are now talking to some of the leading and good educational institutions to maybe tweak the program, some of the say the MBA programs or whatever, and right. make them specialized for this kind of lending. You know, why can't we have an MBA graduate who specializes in say micro lending, or somebody who specializes in it? Why we only have MBA finance general?
Right.
You know, why can't we have a specialized person in insurance, specialized person in small time lending? You know, with that kind of education background. And obviously that has to be a joint effort between the industry and the education system and the policymakers. We are trying to work on that. I think that will be another very important aspect to be brought.
Okay. Noted your points, gentlemen. Let me come with another thought here. So Alokji, you know, I was talking to somebody who was a foreigner working in India's IT company, worked here for 15 years. And what he liked the most is that a lot of Indians eat on a banana leaf. When he went to USA, he started that business. Okay. And he became a millionaire by sharing those, you know, plates made out of banana leaf under the Green Revolution and ESG and so many other tags. Now, here, don't we know that the banana leaves in India, I mean, everybody knows about it. But I know a lot of MSMEs who wanted to make a business out of it. I know a lot of micro entrepreneurs wanted to make a business out of it. But banks refused, saying that, one, you are not under the organized sector. Second, you do not have a credit history. Third, you know, you are not under that typical tag of a formalization. And that's why they could not reach to a level where they could have reached earlier. So now my question to you is, but again, changes are happening. Now GST is giving a great data. There are some, you know, websites actually offering them, a lot of context. And third, digitalization has helped it. My question to you, since both of you said that things are changing, it will not happen one day, but it's gradually happening. Once such micro entrepreneurs will get boost, will get credit, what kind of changes do you see in this kind of sector once they are allowed to the whole credit system?
Amol, let me also start by saying that this is already happening. While they may not be getting a loan of 50 lakhs or 25 lakhs, but gradually as they move up in the microfinance value chain also, no, all the banana leaves and dona makers, all are welcome. And there are so many examples I will show you. If you go to Puri or any other temple in Tirupati, near all the stalls selling those items in dona and patalna, they are all microfinance clients. But it is at a small scale. And as you rightly said, the system helps them build their credit history because their data is reported to the credit bureau. So in first cycle, you might get 40,000 loan. In 5 years down the line, when you are in fifth cycle, you might go up to 1 lakh or something like that. When by that time, your credit record is there in the credit bureau. You have taken 5-6 cycles and the whole idea is then you should move up. And if your credit need is 5 lakh or 10 lakh, which is not allowed under regulatory norms for microfinance, you can move up to a bank and banks should have confidence. And when you say that, typically what we have found is, and I think everybody knows in India, that 1 to 2 lakh, 1 to 1.5 lakh microfinance covers. Okay. Now, banking lending between 2 lakh to 5 lakh, 6 lakh, 10 lakh, what is that lost middle portion? You cannot quantify it exactly. But there is a gap, huge gap, where the entrepreneur needs, 4 lakhs, where the NBFC, MFI cannot go there, where banks will not go that much down. So that has to be filled. We have been talking to RBI. We say that when you define microfinance limit, now that harmonized regulation is coming and it will equalize the level playing field between banks and NBFCs, I have suggested, at MFIN, we have suggested, when you define that this is below this household income limit, is only the microfinance client, why don't you raise it? Because that's the max limit. Because what it leads to is only denial of credit. It's not necessary that I will always lend to 4 lakh household income client, but at least it gives me scope. It doesn't leave that crack in between. It is very important because if that does not happen, when earlier in my academic role, I always used to say that if 90% of people are left behind, their credit needs are not fulfilled, they are not part of mainstream economy, however good GDP growth you may have, however big cities and smart cities you may have, the foundation will not be strong. If you want to, John Keynes, I think I said that when there is a high tide, all boats will go up. But that is not happening. The trickle down is not happening. So we have to be focused on them. And that is very important segment. And I think NBFCs have a critical role to play in that. Where NBFC MFI don't go, NBFCs go there. They're 2 to 8 lakh. But still there is a huge unmet demand. It needs to be fulfilled. I think banks, we have tried through, you have seen 2-3 years back, the government initiative of PSB loans in 59minutes.com that was targeted at this segment. And it has not, I would say, reached the scale which it should have. So NBFCs have a role to play in that whether it is 10,000 loan or up to 10 lakh loan. And that is a very critical segment of India. The right. Honorable Prime Minister policy, everybody keeps talking about inclusive India. If inclusive India has to be built, it has to be built on the foundation of these customers.
Noted your points. And Ramanji, your views as well, since you're talking about the future.
Yes, I think, Amol, I would directly relate your query to the risk appetite.
Right? Right.
So what we can quickly tell me, what is the risk appetite of the lending? And I think I need not say history speaks for itself.
Right.
The risk appetite of NBFCs, I don't think needs to be proven or spoken about. Everybody knows it.
Mm-hmm.
Had we not been carrying high risk appetite, today we would not have seen the kind of lending which has happened by NBFCs. I straight cite examples. Let's go 40 or 50 years back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we were at the same stage, even a basic thing like used three-wheeler funding or a used tempo funding was akin to what you just mentioned, somebody trying to make an entrepreneurship out of a banana leaf. It was as novice as new at that point. Who took the credit call? It was the NBFCs. Yes. Similarly, we have got many examples where NBFCs have been the ones to first take the credit call on so-called untapped new age, you can say startups, as that's the fashion of the day, startups, the startups of the old era. It was the NBFCs who always took the first credit call. In fact, I was part of a task force done by, constituted by one of the leading chambers, where the study found this. That in fact, NBFCs are the first to take credit call on unbanked or a new kind of a borrower. And ultimately, the borrower will use our track record and mature to become a bankable borrower. So in fact, NBFCs at times act as conduits to converting an unbanked borrower to a bank borrower. So it's, you know, risk appetite on the part of NBFCs has been proven time and again. And even now, there are NBFCs, as Alokji has also mentioned. I don't think there is any dearth of risk appetite here. NBFCs are very hungry. Some very, very interesting new models. I mean, I was recent as just about a week or 10 days back, I was sitting with one of the new age NBFCs. Fantastic ideas. I mean, the kind of using the technology and digital means, the new age lending which is happening, quote unquote, with all the checks in place, is exactly ready to take risk. So I don't see any dearth of risk appetite when it comes to NBFCs or the NBFC MFIs, because MFIs, I don't see them separately. I think MFIs we are all part of the same NBFC fraternity overall. It's just that, yet there are certain categories, and rightly so, done by the regulator to ensure some kind of a differentiation. But broadly, we are the ones, because these guys, I mean, MFINs, of course, look at them. They go deep, right deep into the rural areas, you know,
right,
and take a credit call. So risk appetite is there. No dearth of that. I can assure you on that.
And Amol, just to add this brief point here.
Sure.
Not only we go deep, we go unsecured. We don't have the backup collateral. Huh?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And also, let me add one point that I have always emphasized with the Reserve Bank the only concern which you can have, because there are number of NBFCs is too large and regulatory, so governance issues and all those things. Huh? We are open to any scrutiny. on governance, on the integrity aspects. You, SRO is there. You can delegate functions to us. We will do that for you as a second tier of it. So no questions. There is nothing. If you want more higher standards of governance, more deeper insights into the governance and the processes, open to it.
Yes.
But be flexible.
Flexible. And Amol, remember what we began by saying. I'll cite your example. Imagine you treat a new age entrepreneur who's trying to make a business out of banana leaves and put him at par with the norms you prescribe for a borrower who's borrowing for a Mercedes car. Does that justify?
Yes.
So that flexibility in the regulation and the policy making has to be there. Very important.
Meaningful thoughts, Ramanji, Alokji. I think very, very valid points, relevant points. Risk appetite is also a very, very interesting point. And I would have taken a few more questions, but the time is limited. You know, I think it's been almost more than 40 minutes since we have been talking, and it's a meaningful conversation. I must say, I'm sure the participants, you know, would love, must have taken some notes from both of you. So thank you, Ramanji and Alokji, for sharing remarkable perspective at TTBFSR Converge. And let's stay connected and keep this conversation ahead. And let's think about the inclusive India, you know, in a far more meaningful manner. Thank you so much, Alokji, and thank you so much, Ramanji.
Thank you so much. Thank you.